let's do tonight talk about this very important subject of premillennialism. Now, I think that probably those of you who have been with us on this study by now, you probably know the basic definition of premillennial, but I'm going to go ahead just to nail it down very, very quickly. And that is, a premillennialist believes that the second coming of Jesus Christ will happen pre-millennium. That is, first the second coming, and following that would be the thousand-year reign of Christ. Now, a premillennialist would believe in a physical, earthly reign of Jesus Christ. So, a premillennialist is one who believes Christ is coming again someday, and he is going to reign on this earth. He is going to provide that new age, that millennial age, that messianic age, that utopian age, if you will, and the time when justice flows down like the mighty stream, and the desert blooms, and the wolf and the lamb are together, and all of these pictures that were given in Isaiah 11, the 11th chapter, and other passages, this is the millennium. So, as we consider this very issue here, I want us to talk a little bit about premillennialism in history, which is why I recommended you get the book Dispensationalism Before Darby at dispensationalpublishing.com, because it'll give much more than I'm going to give you tonight. I want to give you a little taste of where premillennialism has been down through history. Now, first of all, I would say that seldom has premillennialism received fair treatment among theologians, either in the past or the present. The whole bucket of evidence has been dumped out against premillennialism. In fact, just the other day, I put up an advertisement at our church, Taos First Baptist Church, for upcoming sermons that I'm about to do. And this Sunday I'll be preaching about the rapture, and I put that on our Facebook page, and of course it's public out there, and got some comments, of course, from some people who are saying, you know, that's heresy, that's garbage. Now, they're talking about the rapture, not necessarily the millennium, but they're saying a pre-trib rapture is garbage. Now, you put premillennialism out there in general, and dispensational premillennialism out there specifically, and you will be attacked pretty quickly. Most of you already know this because you have been there and done that. And yet, there is, as I see going on in the chat box, this group of parrots out there that are repeating the same line: Darby invented dispensationalism and premillennialism, and none of it even existed before that. Well, unfortunately, if you talk about premillennialism in history, you have to say it really has seldom received any kind of fair treatment. That is, I'm a product of a Southern Baptist seminary. Premillennialism did not receive fair treatment, I can tell you, and dispensationalism didn't receive treatment. I didn't even know what it was when I got out of seminary. And so that's true in Southern Baptist seminaries. I think it's still, by and large, true today. One or two of them may be better than they were back in the day when I was there. But by and large, a graduate of a Southern Baptist seminary has no clue what dispensationalism even is, other than they're against it, they don't like it. But it's not just Southern Baptist seminaries, I can tell you. It is every kind of mainline seminary, every kind of Reformed seminary, every kind of Catholic seminary, and on the list goes. About the only place you're going to find a fair treatment is in very small Bible colleges, which, by the way, if one of you is considering going into the ministry, you probably should consider a small Bible college somewhere. And by small, I mean, don't worry about it. If it's got 15 students or 20 students, 25 students, that's great. Go for it. And you can have a very good ministry and get a solid grounding in the Word of God by some men of God who are going to teach you according to the Word. Now, that's not to say every big one's going to be bad, but it's going to say, I don't know which big one I would recommend you to, but I do know some small ones I would recommend you to. Unfair treatment almost across the board. Now, down through history, really the complete evidence of history shows that premillennialism was the undisputed worldview among Christians and Jews until the time of Augustine in the 4th century. I think that you just really can't emphasize this enough. Prior to Augustine, nobody but nobody but nobody taught anything but premillennialism. Undisputed. It was there. And you press an amillennialist there, and if they have any degree of integrity at all, they're going to admit this is a view that started with Augustine. Not before that. And certainly, as we're going to walk through the Old Testament and the New Testament today, certainly not in the pages of Scripture. So let's just begin that journey here. And reading one of the comments here, let me just go back to something I was saying on the controversy that was given here. And this is someone referred to dispensationalists as being called nut jobs. Yeah, they're crazy. They're wackos. Even heretics is often what they're called. And yet, it is the view that was held in the Old Testament, that was held in the New Testament, that was held by Jews, that was held by, I believe, the apostles, and I'll try to prove that tonight, that was held by the early church up until the time of Augustine. This is what is held. In fact, I want to show you something here, and we're going to try something that may or may not work for us on a video I'd like to show you. But it's a video that shows that even modern Israel still today believes in premillennialism. Certainly they believe in a millennium, and the video I'm about to show you is going to be of Shimon Peres, the president of Israel, who just recently died, and he's talking in a great sense about the millennial age, and I want to try to show it to you here, we may have a sound issue, so we're going to see what we can do here, and I believe what I'm going to do is switch the sound to the video, and I was going to try to give some running commentary, but because we'll end up with four or five of me running at the same time with this sound, we're going to go and just let the video play and see if this works. We'll be watching your comments. If it doesn't work, we'll stop the video. We're just going to, I tell you what, we're going to go back here a little bit, and I'm going to talk through some of these subtitles, and then we'll start it. This is Shimon Peres. Now, look what he says. When I look ahead, I see a world that knows no limits, no boundaries. I see a world, no limits, no boundaries. A world of ongoing progress. Now, can I stop right here? This world of no limits, no boundaries, ongoing progress. He's seeing this. This is a Jewish leader. This is, of course, the millennium. Now, he really, in a sense, this sounds very post-millennial, and it is kind of that. But he sees a millennium, a messianic age out there. Now, we'll continue. He goes on to say, I witnessed the miracle of science reinventing Israel generation after generation. Now, that particular phrase right there actually is something very post-millennial, honestly, that rather than a Messiah, he's saying the miracle of science. But nonetheless, he's saying something out there miraculous is going to change things. I believe it enables us to live to the value of tikkun olam, a Jewish phrase. And you see, he was somewhat ecumenical by the people he's hanging around here. And then he goes on to say, you wouldn't believe it, but I've been young. He's speaking at APAC here a number of years ago. And now I grow older, as the psalm says. But I feel I have the right with all of what I have seen to be an optimist. Now, in a real sense, a millennialist is an optimist. They see a better age coming. And for a premillennialist, in a sense, he's, you know, it's hard to say, is he postmillennial or premillennialism, but he's looking for a time out there when things get better. Now, he's an optimist. What's he looking for? It goes on to say, my generation experienced serious trials and tribulations. We triumphed over them all. Of course, he was of the generation that created the state of Israel and a Holocaust survivor. Let's make this generation the last to know conflict, the last to know bloodshed. Now, that statement right there is saying, let's us. Let's usher in a generation that is the last to know conflict and bloodshed. I'm convinced that that is never going to happen. A premillennialist would say, let's. We can't do it. We can't build the kingdom. We can't better the world. And we're going to talk more about this. He goes on, and once again, sorry we don't have the sound to all of this and the beautiful music that is behind it from this APAC video, but as he continues this thought, he says, let's make this generation the first to enjoy redemption. That's very Jewish, very biblical, actually. It will make our heritage our destiny. Can I show you that the Jewish people today still are looking toward redemption? They're looking for the future heritage, that is, the promises to Abraham will be their destiny. He gets this all from the scripture. He just fails to rest it upon the Messiah's shoulders here. And what a terrible mistake then, obviously, that is, 1923 to 2016, Shimon Peres. You can get this in the Facebook page, I know, of APAC. It'll be there. Well, with that, let's talk about this premillennialism in the Old Testament in the Hebrew Scriptures. Now, I would like to say the foundational information for premillennialism is found in the Old Testament. A premillennial doctrine can be completely built in the Old Testament. So, you want to understand, or you want, let me say this differently. You don't need Revelation chapter 20 to become a premillennialist, because all of Jesus and his apostles and the prophets, they were all premillennial. They didn't know to put the name Jesus on it, but all through the Old Testament, it is out there. Someday Messiah will come, and when Messiah comes, then this millennial age, they wouldn't have called it the millennium. The only thing we get out of Revelation chapter 20 that we didn't previously know is that there is a portion of it that is 1,000 years, thus we call it the millennium. They would have, of course, called it the Messianic Age, and they had to have a Messiah for the Messianic Age. So I just want you to so understand millennialism is rooted in the Old Testament. Now, Walvoord says on page 114, the premillennial interpretation offers the only possible literal fulfillment for hundreds of verses of prophetic testimony. If you're not a premillennialist, then there are hundreds of verses of prophecy that you simply cannot take literally. You will not take them literally. You will spiritualize or allegorize them. Now, if this is the case, that premillennialism is so rooted in the Old Testament, then how do the people who are amillennialists, how do they escape this? This very basic truth that the Old Testament is premillennial. They do two things, one of two things. They don't do both of them. But one is they say a literal interpretation of Scripture is wrong. That is, they will say the error of premillennialism is making the same mistakes the Jews made. A literal interpretation is wrong. Now, let me tell you that that's actually a very common, even in the evangelical world, which I don't associate with, that's a very common interpretation that if you interpret these promises literally, you are wrong. The Jews were wrong too. We're taught so often in evangelical seminaries, the apostles didn't get it right. They didn't understand. The prophets didn't get it right. They didn't understand. They thought it was going to be literal. When it was not going to be literal, it was going to be spiritual. A literal interpretation is wrong. Let me tell you, these same people, for the most part, are very willing also to accept that Genesis chapter 1 is wrong if you take a literal interpretation, a six-day creation. I remember to this day, I had a survey book of the Old Testament. We sell a survey book of the Old Testament at Dispensational Publishing. I would much rather you get that. We don't sell the one I used in seminary, and it was by three professors, Lasore, Hubbard, and Bush. And I remember reading how they were telling us how Jesus interpreted the Old Testament spiritually, not literally. And we're supposed to follow Jesus. Now, what they were saying is this argument right here, that a literal interpretation of the scripture is wrong. That's one path that amillennialists will take. A second path is they'll say, well, the kingdom promises of the Old Testament required faith and obedience, and since Israel failed, the promises will never be fulfilled. Now, in other words, they say, no, the promises were literal, but they required obedience, and since they didn't have obedience, they're simply not going to be fulfilled. Now, I do want you to note that these are mutually exclusive arguments. One assumes that the literal interpretation is right. The other assumes the literal interpretation is wrong, and clearly that doesn't work together. So the amillennialists take these two routes of escape to get away from premillennialism in the Old Testament, and they disagree really with one another in the very thing that they are attempting to do here. I think, by the way, it's so much better just to say the Old Testament teaches premillennialism. The Old Testament teaches a Messiah is going to come and then there's going to be a kingdom age. Let's face it, that's what it is. Now, what about into the New Testament? Chris gives a very good comment on the chat box. He says, if the Old Testament is wrong, then what's the point of having a Messiah in the first place? And I think this is very true. You know, the Old Testament mentions Micah chapter 5, verse 2, which I'm going from recollection here, but it talks about how Messiah is going to be born in Bethlehem. You, Bethlehem, land of Judah, you're by no means least among the leaders of Judah. Out of you shall come forth a ruler who will shepherd my people, Israel. You know, it's such a very clear picture that Messiah is coming. He's coming in Bethlehem. He's going to shepherd. The word shepherd, by the way, is sometimes translated rule. It's the same word. He will rule my people Israel. And so you do have just this unbelievable problem of where do you define what's literal and what's not. And this is the huge hickey on the neck of an amillennian, if I may say it that way. Now, you come into the New Testament. Is there premillennialism in the New Testament? Actually, I think that didn't do my animation very good, so we'll go with the whole screen there. The New Testament really gives plenty of evidence that the promises of the kingdom are literal. For example, the angel Gabriel comes to Mary. And I like what Walvoord says on page 117. Did Mary for one moment hold the amillennialian view? No, she didn't. And in fact, the angel comes to Gabriel. You may remember, let me get this right. Gabriel the angel comes to Mary and he says, the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David and he will rule over the house of Jacob forever. That is the announcement, the birth announcement. Now, that appears to be premillennial. He's coming through you, Mary. He is going to be given the throne, and he is going to rule. The throne of David, ruling over the house of Jacob. That's as premillennial as you can get, really. You get into the teachings of Jesus Christ. Walvoord said it better than I ever could. It says, Jesus never denied, corrected, or altered, but instead he confirmed. Now, you take some of these teachings, and we'll give some of the grounds, or some of the three examples, there are many, of Jesus and the issue of the kingdom. And very clearly, in these illustrations, you're going to see that they have a premillennial view. The Messiah will come. The Messiah will set up the kingdom, which is after his arrival. This is their view. And he didn't deny it. He didn't correct them. He didn't alter it, but he confirmed it. Now, if all these blabbing preachers out there are right that the kingdom is really spiritual, not physical, then and it's current and not future, then Jesus, he ought to be scolded because he allowed this heinous idea of premillennialism that these people incorrectly held. He allowed them to continue holding it. He didn't deny it. He didn't correct it. He didn't alter it. He confirmed it. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm just going to say, if it was good enough for the prophets and is good enough for the angel Gabriel and is good enough for Jesus Christ, it'll be good enough for me. It's right there in the pages of Scripture. Now, here's some of the examples of how the teachings of Christ confirmed. You remember the request of James and John? When you establish your kingdom, let one of my sons sit at your right and one sit at your left. And Jesus said, why, mother of thunder? Don't you know that the kingdom is not physical? I'm not going to have a seat on my right hand and a seat on my left hand. There'll be no place for them to sit. Where did you get this crazy idea? You need to know that the kingdom is when we advance the gospel around the world and the whole world becomes Christian. That's the kingdom. He didn't do that, did he? No, not at all. He confirmed her view. There's another one. The apostles were told that they were going to sit and judge on 12 thrones in Israel. They were told this the night of the betrayal, the day before the crucifixion. Each of you, you're going to sit on 12 thrones. Now, that was a very premillennial view. Messiah is going to establish his kingdom, and then we're going to sit on the 12 thrones. That's as biggest confirmation as premillennialism as you could have. Maybe there's an amillennian out there listening to this. Maybe there's a postmillennialist out there. But I want to speak especially to the amillennials. Chew on just these two things right here. Chew on them long and chew on them hard. And if they don't make you choke, then you got to swallow them. And you've really got to change your view. Here's a third one, Acts chapter 1, verse 6. It's one of my favorite. Jesus has been teaching, the scripture says in Acts chapter 1, he's been teaching about the kingdom for 40 days. And the last question they ask is it now you will restore the kingdom to Israel? They're saying it hadn't happened yet. Are you going to do it now? It's very Israel-centered, and it needs to be restored. Like David, it's been in existence once before, and now it needs to rise again. Is it now you're going to do it? And Jesus said to them, I just taught you for 40 days, and you boneheaded apostles still don't get it. The kingdom of God is the advance of the gospel. No, he didn't say that, did he? He didn't deny, correct, or alter, but he confirmed. The only thing he said is, I'm not going to tell you what time. That confirms, doesn't it? Yeah, you're right. You're just not going to know the timing. You get into the teachings of Paul, and he says some things, for example, in Romans chapter 11, verse 1, about the promises of God, and could they be forsaken, for example. Then he says, God forbid. The promises of God, they're solid. He is not going to do away with them. John comes along, and he confirms. I said John 20. This should be Revelation 20. That should be classic, not calcic. Revelation 20 is the classic passage on premillennialism. And, of course, this is the statement that is given, in the 90s, 95 A.D. perhaps. And so long time, towards the end of the first century, he's still teaching premillennialism from the beginning to the end of the New Testament. You see a premillennial doctrine that is given there. So there's really the absence of any hint of millennial controversy in the New Testament. That is, we see some controversies. Speaking in tongues is a controversy. The role of women is a controversy. Gnosticism is a controversy within the Old Testament. Paul speaks to these controversies very strongly. James, he speaks to some controversies. And there are controversies, but not once is there a controversy of the millennium being premillennial. That's because they all accepted it, and it was so right that nobody addressed the issue. So, I have almost gotten, because it affects really the interpretation of Scripture so strongly, that I really don't want to spend my time listening to sermons and reading books by amillennialists like R.C. Sproul and Tim Keller and N.T. Wright and you name it. You can go on and on and on. Rick Warren and blah, blah, blah. They just have no interest to me because I think they have dismissed so much solid interpretation of the Scripture that... It's just, honestly, it's dangerous stuff. So let's look at premillennialism since the New Testament. New Testament closes out, and what have we got? Well, in the first century, each of the early church fathers, we often call them, taught premillennialism. And no less than 15 advocates of premillennialism can be verified from first century extra-biblical documents. That means, by extra-biblical, I don't mean like they're really, really super biblical. I mean they're outside of the Bible. And we've got some written works of people outside of the Bible, like Clement of Rome and Ignatius and Polycarp and whatnot. And George N.H. Peters, in his unbelievably good work called The Theocratic Kingdom. It's very hard to get. If you can find a copy, though, grab it. The Theocratic Kingdom. It's actually in three volumes. And it's exhaustive, building this case for a future premillennial physical kingdom. And he lists 15 early church fathers that were all premillennial. That's the first century. Come to the second century. And again, it's undisputed. Undisputed premillennialism. Justin Martyr, Irenaeus, Tertullian, others that you've heard of. And they're simply in the second century, there is no opposition to premillennialism that exists at all. First century, they're all premillennial. Second century, they're all premillennial. Then you come to the third century, and this is where the historic decline began, and the allegorizing method of scripture interpretations began to almost take total reign. You've got Augustine that begins to come in here in the third and fourth centuries, and from the third century until now, can I just say it's been downhill? Why has it been downhill? Well, for one, Roman Catholicism. Roman Catholicism has totally, completely, 100% adopted and taught amillennialism. And I might say that's not going to change. The Pope will not change his mind on this. He cannot change his mind on it without the Roman Catholic Church collapsing with no so-called biblical foundation. Amillennialism is required for Catholic polity, that is, Catholic organization. That is, amillennialism is required for the continued existence of the Roman Catholic Church. Because of this, it has been taught very strongly in Roman Catholicism. Now, you say, why are you so strong that it has to be amillennial? It's because they teach that the church is the kingdom. And so for this Holy Roman Empire, this kingdom of the church to continue, what happens if they teach the church is not the kingdom? All of a sudden, their whole governmental structure of papacy and cardinals and bishops and everything, it all crumbles. It all falls apart. They've got to be amillennial. And so that's what happened is, you know, the Roman Catholic Church reigned from, 325 or so anyway, onward. And so amillennialism became the heresy du jour, if you will. Then the Reformation came along about 500 years ago, and it did bring the renewal of personal study of Scripture, and that personal study of Scripture gave birth to modern premillennialism, but unfortunately, the Reformers themselves failed to recognize the amillennial error. So, you take Martin Luther, he's amillennial. You take John Calvin, he's amillennial. On and on you can go with these most of these Reformers, and they're amillennialists. But, at least, they did say a person ought to open the Bible and study for themselves. And that opened up the door to a resurrection, if you will, of this idea of premillennialism. Now, let's talk about modern premillennialism and the DNA, if I can call it that, of premillennialism. And we have a number of things that I would point out. First of all, what's important to modern premillennials? I think the infallibility of Scripture. Now, I have here a note about fundamentalists. Fundamentalists would talk about the inerrancy of Scripture. I'm a fundamentalist, and I would hold strongly to the inerrancy of Scripture and even the verbal plenary inspiration of Scripture. Not all evangelicals, in fact, really most evangelicals, are not, they're not fundamentalists, and they don't all believe in the inerrancy of Scripture, but They would believe in the infallibility of Scripture. Now, you say, what's the difference? They would believe that the general idea of Scripture, and that would include a future millennium, is going to come true. They might hold to a few mistakes in it here and there, but most premillennialists lean towards fundamentalism, not all of them. Certainly dispensationalists do. Another in the DNA of a premillennialist, that is, if you find a premillennialist, you found someone who has a very high view of Scripture. You found someone who believes in the literal interpretation of Scripture. Maybe you were with us last night, or you go and look at the archives of last night as I was talking about a woman's role in church. It's on our website there and on our YouTube page as well. And this, should a woman have a head covering in church? And I said, if you read the Scripture literally, then you don't insist on a head covering. And it's because literally that's what Paul says. And you can look into that last night. But again, find a premillennialist, especially a dispensational premillennialist. You found one who believes in the literal interpretation of Scripture. Then evangelism is very strong among premillennialists. Premillennialists will believe in an orthodox gospel, an opposition to legalism, an emphasis on grace. These are things that just go part and parcel with this issue of premillennialism. Find a premillennialist and you'll find someone who's independent. Rarely do you find a premillennialist who's a part of an ecclesiastical organization. Now, what do I mean about an ecclesiastical organization? I mean things like the National Council of Churches or the World Council of Churches. That's an ecclesiastical organization. And probably even it would be rare to find a premillennialist who is a part of something like the Willow Creek Association or the, I forget what Rick Warren's group is called. And these are ecclesiastical organizations. Now, Willow Creek and Rick Warren's organizations are loose networks, but seldom will a strong premillennialist even be in a loose network. They tend to be independent fundamentalists of whatever sort. They may be independent fundamentalist Baptists. They may be independent fundamentalist Bible church or just, independent fundamentalist, community church, whatever it is. But there's a strong degree of independence and not only not a part of ecclesiastical organizations, and certainly almost never would you find one a part of a mainline denomination. If you did, it would be an anomaly. I have seen one before, but it's very, 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 very rare. And then this independence also is shown in an emphasis on very informal church services and exegetical preaching. So the DNA of a premillennialist, probably they're going to be kind of laid back. We sometimes call it low church as opposed to high church. Very often you'll find just this very informal church services in which people kind of saunter in and they talk to one another, and they might raise their hand and ask a question, and they'll open up and they'll take notes during the service, and they'll say amen and all the things that you wouldn't do in one of the highbrow churches, they'll go ahead and do. This is part of the DNA again of a premillennialist. Now, another thing is they're very prophetically oriented. That is, of course, the millennium is in the future, and so if you find a premillennialist, they've probably been to a prophecy conference. I preached one just this last week in Ohio. So a couple of you were there, and no amillennial church ever had a prophecy conference because it would take like 30 seconds. And a postmillennialist really don't have prophecy conferences either, unless they're either one of those groups are trashing premillennials. Then they might have a conference on that, but that's really about all it goes. This is the modern premillennialist DNA. I don't know about you, but that's a pretty good DNA to have, I think. Let's talk about some premillennial doctrine. And a couple of things that I think are specific to premillennialism, like the doctrine of the present age. For a premillennialist, he would believe there are no prospects of a golden age before the second coming. Earlier when I showed you or tried to show you the video by Shimon Peres, he he was kind of preaching that we can create this this golden age, science and you know, positive spirit or whatever. And yet he was torn a little bit because a good conservative Orthodox Jew would be saying, no, Messiah was going to come. So he kind of gave a mixed message through this. A premillennialist doesn't give a mixed message. There's no prospect of a golden age before the second coming. We're not really looking for some great revival to come along. We're not looking for the government to be taken over by a fundamentalist Christian who's going to change everything. We're not expecting that at all. And we're not expecting that the darkness will turn to the dawning and the dawning to noonday bright and God's great kingdom will come on earth. So no prospects of a golden age. No commands to improve society. Now this is rather interesting that the premillennialist, if he's true to premillennialism, really isn't out there doing a lot of social justice work. He's not trying to fix all the problems of this society. Have you noticed that Paul didn't try to fix his society? He tried to tell believers how to live in it, but didn't try to tell them, you know, how to fix it. There's a lot of stuff going on today, especially in terms of justice movements. Justice is the key word. And when you hear that justice going on, and we're aiming for economic justice, and we're trying to build racial justice, and we're trying to build gender justice, and all this, you know, everything's justice, justice, justice. And we're trying to see it happen, and let's pray for justice, and let's work for justice. I can just tell you, you're not talking to a premillennialist, certainly not a very educated premillennialist, because for the premillennialist, there's no golden age that's going to come until the Messiah comes, and there's no command, go out and usher in justice. Now, rather, evangelism and Bible teaching is the task of Christians today. This is for the doctrine of the present age for the premillennialist is tell people about Jesus Christ and teach them the Bible. And you will find that when you have a premillennial church or a premillennial ministry like ours or whatever it is, it by and large is going to be focused on verse-by-verse Bible teaching. Because this is our instruction for today. In the present age, study to show thyself approved, a workman who hath no need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. And other instructions like that are given that we are to learn the word and to become like Christ through the renewing of our mind, the transforming of who we are through the word of God. Now, there's a doctrine of Israel as well that's very specific to premillennial doctrine. Protestants down the years have held three views as it relates to Israel. The first view, Calvin is one of them, believed that the church is the true Israel. The nation of Israel, for Calvin, is permanently set aside. God's not going to use it anymore. Can I say, Martin Luther held to this one also, can I say that this idea that the church is the true Israel, we call it replacement theology, that opened up the door for the Holocaust, for example? Because Israel rejected the Messiah. In fact, they put God to death. And God put them off aside. God is done with them. And one thing led to another until, well, if God's done with them, we should be done with them too. And the Holocaust was born. So Calvin, so many of the reformers were right here. The church is true Israel. Now, there's another view that Protestants held. William Hendrickson held this view. Charles Hodge held this view. This is the idea that Israel's promises are to Israel, but only to the part of Israel that comes into the church. And those promises will be fulfilled in the present age. So they had kind of a distinction that when a Jew is saved, that was the true Israel, and they were a part of the church, and God was going to do some things for that part of Israel. Not Israel as a whole, but that part of Israel that was within the church. And there was a blending there of the two. And now both of these views, let me just say, cancel out some of the promises as conditional and spiritualize other promises. It just you just have to in either one of these views. Let me say, I don't have it on here and it wasn't in Walvoord's book, but I think there's a third view that now has become somewhat popular. And it's a subpoint of Calvin's view here of the church is the true Israel. And there are those like Russell Moore of the Southern Baptist Ethics and Religious Liberty Commission who teach this view. And that is, he would say, no, I don't believe that the church is true Israel. But if you press him on it, he also doesn't believe that Israel is the true Israel. He does believe that the nation of Israel is set aside permanently. God's not going to do anything with the nation of Israel. So how are the promises of Israel going to be fulfilled? He would say, Jesus is the true Israel. So it's a different kind of replacement theology, but it's a replacement theology nonetheless. It does not believe that the physical descendants of Abraham are the true Israel. Then the third view is the view of premillennialism, and that is the prophecies to Israel are literal, they are unconditional, they are future, God is going to provide those someday. Now, let's move to the last subject of the evening, and that is premillennialism and the church. And as we consider three types of millennial ecclesiology, let's look at this word right here. That's not eschatology. Eschatology is the study of end things. Ecclesiology is the study of the ecclesia, or church. So, churchmanship, if you will, or church order and church organization. There are three types of millennial ecclesiology, such as covenant theology. I think this is a great definition of covenant theology right here from page 222 of Walvoord's book. He says, covenant theology conceives the purpose of God as essentially soteriological. We'll come back to this. Or concerned with the salvation of the elect. Now, soteriology is, soter is salvation. So the study of salvation or related to salvation. And specifically, as he says, the salvation of the elect. This is covenant theology. Covenant theology opens the Bible and says, if you're in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, wherever you are, it is about God saving the elect. And so you look into it to see how's God saving and sanctifying me. That's what the Bible is about for covenant theology. Therefore, every stage of God's work is simply a progression of God's work to fulfill what they would call the covenant of redemption. Israel, therefore, just merges into the church. Israel is the Old Testament church. The believers today, the body of Christ, is the New Testament church. And this is just a flow of what God is doing, not a separate dispensation. In fact, a covenant theologian really doesn't believe in a dispensation. They believe in some progressive revelation, but it's just a continuing act of what God is doing. There's never a dividing line that cuts things out, covenant theology. Then there's kingdom theology. I think kingdom theology is very much growing today in the evangelical or so-called evangelical world. The kingdom for this group includes the work of the church in this age and the millennium in the future. Now catch that. The kingdom includes both. That's why the church can come and say, let's do kingdom work, let's build the kingdom, let's advance the kingdom, let's give to the kingdom, let's pray for the kingdom, and let's work in the kingdom. The work of the church and the future of the millennium all together is the kingdom. The emphasis is soteriological, that's about salvation, rather than governmental. That's important. For these with kingdom theology, they're not looking for a coming day in which the Messiah is going to reign. They're looking rather for a coming day in which everyone is going to be saved. So, for kingdom theology, the kingdom is internal over external. I might say spiritual over physical. This is a very important idea here. When you minimize the governmental character of the kingdom, you end up building a theology of moralism that leads to liberalism or the social gospel or socialism or justice, social justice, economic justice, again, all these things. And This becomes very much a moralistic kind of goodness kind of church. Then there's dispensational theology. And dispensational theology, I think to be a dispensationalist, you got to have at least three dispensations. The dispensation of law and grace and kingdom. And those are very strongly divided. The dispensation of grace, which we are in, is not the kingdom. The kingdom is not in this dispensation, nor is law in this dispensation. Divide those very strongly, and you'll be a dispensationalist. Believers, then, in the present age, are separated in duty from believers in the dispensation of the law and believers in the dispensation of the kingdom. We're in the dispensation of grace as it comes. Now, we're going to pick up next week and talk about the church in dispensational theology. And we started here just this moment of looking at some of that. But for premillennialists, and especially dispensational premillennialists, they view the church very strongly. And, you know, the covenant theology, again, is going to see the church back there in the Old Testament, the church in the wilderness, they might talk about, the church in the kingdom, in the Davidic kingdom. They would talk about the church in exile. They would talk about the church the days of Paul the Apostle. They would talk about the church in the heavenly church in the future, all sorts of churches all over the place. But dispensational theology related to the millennium is going to have a very strong distinction of this age of the church as a mystery. Now, we're going to look at it next week, and I think it'll be interesting because some of the things that I have taught have been, controversial, and that is because of my view on the beginning of the church, even more so the beginning of the age of grace. And so let's talk about this next week. We're going to see what Walvoord has to say. We're going to see what I have to say, and let's see what the scripture has to say, and look at all of that, and I think it'll be a blessing next week, and then after that, the weekend. After that, we will start our new series, Lord willing, our new series on the study of Song of Solomon. I think it'll be a very interesting study, a journey that we take in the Song of Solomon. So, God bless you for being here tonight. I would certainly entertain a few questions. Some of you may need to be dismissed, and we understand that, especially on the East Coast, getting a little late for you, we understand. But if you can stick around for a Q&A time, we'll take just a few minutes and answer a few questions that you might have on this Bible study or any question that's Bible, theology, worldview, something going on in church or society, whatever it is, put it on there, and I'll aim for it. So go ahead and put that in the chat box now, if you will. And I will ask you go to our website, randywhiteministries.org. We've got a new article up there that was just posted, I believe, on Tuesday of this week. And it has to do with our purpose for being on this earth. Often, when you're in Sunday school anyway, they say, why did God put you here? And why did God create us? And very often, one of the top two answers is God created us for fellowship. Well, I've written an article that says God doesn't need your fellowship. That's not why He created us. Another very popular answer, by the way, is that God created us for His glory. This comes from the Westminster Catechism, very covenantal view. And as good as that one sounds, and I used to teach it, I'm not so sure that He created us for His glory. Even because, He was fully glorious even without us. And he wasn't lacking some in glory and needed a creation to complete His glory. So go and read that article there. If you will. And I so appreciate those of you who give some donations to us from time to time, like in our Club 8 or Club 360. It is a blessing, helps us to keep the lights on here, keep things going in these broadcasts. And our toll-free number is 855-437-9448. If it's easy to remember, just try 855-4-DR-WHITE. And you can call and sign up even on the telephone for Club 8 or Club 360, $8 a month or $30 a month or $96 a year or $360 a year, however you'd like to do that. It's always a blessing. We appreciate that. And are blessed. I am glad, Linda, that you are ready for a doubleheader. God bless you. I appreciate people who love to study the Bible and see what it is that God is going to say. And that's, you know, I just, I love studying the Bible and teaching the Bible. And if I could study and teach all day long, I would do that. You know, originally, I'm teaching right now this 30 things that you need to know if you claim to know your Bible. And I've been teaching it 1 week at a time. But originally, I conceived this, and this was before I moved, I conceived this as 30 days of preaching. And every night, I was going to preach. And in a month's time, I would have completed this series that has taken now, you know, I started in January, and we're at number 25 now. I could preach and teach all day long. So, Linda, may your tribe increase. And let me see here what I've got in terms of questions. Chris says, for people who are against premillennialism, what drives it is the fear of what is going to possibly come when the rapture occurs in a person who doesn't agree with premill. Now, this question here then is basically at the heart of the question there and a suggestion. To answer is why this fear of premillennialism? Why this animosity of premillennialism? And he says, you know, could it be, hey, you know, I'm afraid what happens if this happens here? Well, the answer, in a sense, is we don't know because there's just so much out there, and it's been out there for such a long time that it's hard to put together. Back in, I believe it was the first session, maybe the second session of this particular study, I did talk about some of the flow of how, I believe it was the session on postmillennialism, number two in this series, about how postmillennialism took over when amillennialism looked like it had failed, and the millennium didn't come after 1,000 years, and amillennialism was beginning not to make sense. And amillennialism then later, as postmillennialism was really growing in the 1700s and 1800s, the amillennialists needed to get some more people on their side. And so as postmillennialism in World War I and II, say between 1915 and 1945, during that time, postmillennialism was crumbling. Well, the amillennialists wanted to build their ranks, I think. And so they began to attack the premillennialists so that the postmillennialists would not go to the premillennialists, but rather would come to the amillennialists. Now, that's I hope you followed that. It almost needed a map on all of that. But I would, I'd put it somewhat in that kind of a neighborhood. Bob asked, did you ever meet Jon Walvoord? I did not, and I wish that I had, along with Dr. Pentecost and even Dr. Ryrie and several of these others. I am a Johnny come lately to the world of dispensationalism. And I can remember, by the way, this has not been so many years ago, probably 15 years ago, I had heard of Dallas Theological Seminary, where Dr. Walvoord was, and somebody told me, they said, do you know that they require their students to sign a commitment that they are premillennialists before they will graduate? They had to testify they were premillennialists, or the school wouldn't graduate them. First of all, let me say, I don't know if that's true anymore. Maybe I don't even know if it was true back then. But I was thinking, why, my goodness, how terrible this is, because I had swallowed the Kool-Aid that I had been served. And it was after that that I began to study and I began to do some work, and I began to wish that I was a graduate of the old-time Dallas Theological Seminary. I'm not so thrilled with the new-time Dallas Theological Seminary, but the old-time stuff, man, they had some good dispensational premillennialism stuff that was coming out of there that really in a lot of ways transformed even the church world and the world of Christianity. So, wish I had met some of those. Closest I came is I met Dr. W.A. Criswell one time, and Dr. Criswell was a dispensational premillennialist of the first order, I'd say. He was a very good one. He was at the First Baptist Church of Dallas, and yet Dr. Criswell, once president of the Southern Baptist Convention, he was also roundly criticized by all of the who's who within the Southern Baptist Convention, especially in the seminaries. And in fact, he wrote a book in 1969 when he became president of the Southern Baptist Convention. He wrote a book called Why I Preach That the Bible is Literally True. And if you look into the history of that a little bit, there was an uproar in the Southern Baptist Convention among the upper echelon of denominational leadership. They were appalled that he would write a book and that the what was then called the Baptist Sunday School Board, Lifeway, that the Baptist Sunday School Board would publish it. In fact, Baptist Sunday School Board had to be forced to publish it by the grassroots, because in that day, the grassroots, there were a lot of premillennialists, dispensational premillennialists anyway, and so I got off a long ways there. But Dr. Criswell was a premillennialist, and he and Dr. Walvoord no doubt met and would have gotten along just very well. Thank you, Jack, for doing more studies than we can keep up with. I sometimes do more studies than I can keep up with. It happens from time to time. Let me see here where I am. Coming from Bill has a very good word here related to what's the attack on premillennialism, and the comment is, don't you think it's a lack of scripture knowledge? And ultimately, when you look into the scripture, you have to come out a premillennialist. And that lack of scripture knowledge, I think very often, especially among, again, the grassroots, very much the case there. Great word there, Bill. Thank you. Let's see, Jeff asked if I've read any of the works of Robert, I hope I pronounce it right, Govet, and Harry Bultema, and the answer is no, so I can't answer anything on that. If you will send me an email, I might look into it and see what's out there and see what they're teaching, and maybe I can give some commentary on that just by looking into some of the associations or some of the assumptions that they make. Jim brings a good word, Jim in South Carolina, about this change in the internet that comes in October 1st. And I am not as up on this as I ought to be, but I do know there's a lot of concern about it and what is happening there. I think that dispensational premillennialists and fundamentalists ought to build networks so that we know each other, so that we can communicate in times that perhaps it's not as easy as it is to do today. On Nicholas's question, why the animosity towards the rapture, I think it goes right along in with the premillennialism that it's all attacked together. Boy, there is that animosity. It was on our church's Facebook page this week that we got a number of attacks, a couple of them anyway that I read. I haven't been back to see if they've responded any further. But it's out there. You put it publicly, and just they will say it's pie in the sky, it's crazy. In fact, the word that was used on the Facebook is, that's heretical. If you're going to teach a pre-trib rapture, that's heretical. Now, they won't ever really come and deal with the scriptures. They just lob these tomatoes out there, or stones, or bombs, or whatever they are. I wish I knew why the animosity there. And again, it probably goes back to what Bill says in the lack of knowledge towards scripture. Thanks for that update there on DTS, Kim, that I tend to agree with you that it's probably not true anymore, about what DTS is requiring. And that's a good word, Kim. Thank you. Stillwater Baptist Church in Oklahoma, a great pre-trib pastor named James Bond. I'm not aware of James Bond, that particular James Bond, JB, as you say they call him. But you all check out our dispensational church list, and maybe we'll get that Stillwater Baptist Church on there. Daryl, that's a good question. I should have some baby pictures up here, shouldn't I? Most definitely of young Jackson, who is doing so very well. I do appreciate each one of you being on Bible study tonight. It's always a blessing to be with you. This Sunday, I'll be back with you. Let me tell you a little transition I'm making now that I've been here a year. I tend to have advertised everything in Central Time because that's where I previously was. But I live in Mountain Time and broadcast in Mountain Time. So I'm going to start putting everything up in Mountain Time. So be sure to do the calculations when you check things. But at 9:45 Mountain Time, I will be broadcasting the 13th chapter of the book of Hebrews. And we've been in the book of Hebrews 30 weeks now and coming right down to a landing of that thing. So you can join me 9:45. You can always catch the archives for that as well. And then at about 11:15, roughly 11:15, when our preaching starts here, that's again Mountain Time, I'm going to be preaching number 25 of 30 Things You Need to Know. And the next six things in 25 through 30 is a discussion of the end time. So this Sunday, I am going to be preaching about the rapture. That's 11:15 Mountain Time. And find both of those again, go to randywhiteministries.org and click the live stream button. And by tomorrow, those will be up there by tomorrow afternoon. And you will see those on there. And then, of course, next week we'll be broadcasting everything as we normally do live as well. You can find me at randy@randywhiteministries.org. Again, if you need something, you can call and leave us a message or call and update any of your donor information or give one-time gifts, anything you'd like to do that you can't find on the website how to do it, or you just want to talk to a person, call 855-437-9448. We've got some wonderful ladies. He's working for a company that are doing some help for us there, answering those phone calls, and you can do that 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Well, until then, I hope to see you online on facebook.com/randywhiteministries. Check out dispensationalpublishing.com as well, and if you missed my little advertisement at the beginning, we got this new book, Dispensationalism Before Darby. It's on sale up this week for $19.95, regular $24.95. So save $5, and you'll enjoy the book if you like studying this history that we've studied tonight. Let me lead us in a word of prayer.